To understand why one Bitcoin could be worth $1 million, we have to understand why bee colonies are collapsing. Let me explain. In 1997, a curious mycologist by the name of Paul Stamets observed a unique behavior demonstrated by honeybees. The bees went out of their way to consume water containing mushroom spores. That's interesting, thought Paul. 15 years later, Paul started to connect the dots. Honeybees were dying at an unprecedented rate due to colony collapse disorder. The bees were dying in part by infestations of varroa mites, which transmit deadly viruses such as deformed wing virus and Lake Sinai virus. Chemicals used in modern agriculture poison the bees, so their immune systems are too weak to fend off the varroa mites. As bees travel around, they spread the mites to all nearby bees, leading to a 70% decline in bee populations since 2005. And who cares about the bees? Bees are a bedrock species responsible for pollinating a large percentage of our food sources, avocados, almonds, etc. If we lose the bees, there are countless downstream effects such as lost jobs, destroyed ecosystems, and reduced food security. Your produce choices with bees? Your produce choices without bees? Okay, back to our mycologist Paul, who in 2012 made a monumental realization. Fungi are known to support immune systems, so the bees must have instinctively known to drink the fungal water. Paul tested his hypothesis and soon after demonstrated that using a simple antivirus mushroom medicine, we can reduce the effects of deformed wing virus / colony collapse by 80%. Our current central banking-based monetary regime is just like the pesky varroa mites attacking our financial markets. Varroa mites are hard to kill. Fiat currency regimes benefit from a monopoly on violence. They spread viruses on everything they touch. Market distortions, cronyism, regulatory capture. They have negative downstream effects, such as capital misallocation, increased time preference, limits human productivity, and increases risk of catastrophe. Bitcoin is the antivirus or mushroom medicine that saves the bees. Bitcoin or mushroom medicine prevents the spread of our destructive financial hegemony, or varroa mites, which will usher in a new era of human achievements. Just like saving the bees has secondary effects such as ensuring food security. Hey guys, I'm Drew. I turn the most important articles on Bitcoin into documentaries so more people can learn from them. This video is based on Bitcoin is the Mycelium of Money by Brandon Quittem. This is part 3. Subscribe if you want to support this mission. We're heading into a period of uncertainty never before witnessed by our civilization. The fiat money experiment is on shaky ground and our social systems are beginning to break down. Globally, we're facing unprecedented levels of debt to GDP. The Fed, European Central Bank, Bank of Japan, and the Bank of England now appear to own a fifth of their government's total debt. Central banks are running out of moves. In a last-ditch effort, European central banks are pushing negative interest rates. Are we really going to allow the hegemonic banking system to charge depositors for storing our digital fiat in their insecure banks? So how about China? China's real estate market is shaky and long overdue for a correction. Capital controls and seeking yields in a cooling economy have led to an inflated real estate prices. What happens when the market corrects and everyone rushes for the door? Better have a plan B. And the US? The US is currently over $22 trillion in debt. However, don't expect the US to default on their obligations. Former Fed Chairman Alan Greenspan said the United States can pay any debt because we can always print money to do that. Countries around the world are seeking to eliminate physical cash. Cash is a fundamental tool for privacy and is a requirement to maintain an open society. Without physical cash, or Bitcoin, citizens are at the mercy of the financial surveillance machine. A slippery slope indeed. You also can't forget China's social credit system. Soon, China's surveillance technology will be exported all around the world. Our legacy institutions are simply not equipped to deal with the complexity of the information age. Current attempts to fix the political economical machine from the inside are unironically powered by the waste heat of war machine. We need a systemic change, something cut from a different cloth. What if a sound money regime, or Bitcoin, is an antidote to the madness? It is my hope that in the future, we'll look back on our current fiat banking experiment with disgust. How could we live under such an archaic regime for so long? And just like fungi transforms dead and dying organic matter into new life, Bitcoin will transform our decrepit banking system into a robust financial foundation upon which new growth can occur. The great filter of cryptocurrencies. Can Bitcoin survive long enough to reach its full potential? Cypherpunks, anarchists, and voluntarists have been trying to create private, non-government money for a very long time. In fact, modern attempts date back more than 30 years, since the early days of Chaumian e-cash to e-gold and b-money. Despite moderate success of private money before Bitcoin, eventually, they were all shut down by overreaching governments and or business interests. The Great Filter Theory was developed after noticing our lack of success finding intelligent life in the universe. Where is everybody? The theory predicts, during life's evolutionary process, there are some obstacles that are extremely unlikely or impossible to overcome. That obstacle is the Great Filter. For example, what if every time an advanced civilization created nuclear bombs, it ended up destroying itself? In this scenario, it might be statistically improbable to survive long after inventing nuclear weapons. So this is the origin of life, and these are commonly achieved evolutionary leaps. And then this is the evolutionary leap that almost no species manages to make, i.e. the Great Filter. But one species, which through freak events, makes it past the Great Filter, and then you become a Type 3 civilization. For cryptocurrencies, the Great Filter is surviving nation-state level attacks. Bitcoin is the only monetary species that has a chance of surviving the Great Filter. More on this below. But why would a nation-state or entrenched business want to attack a competitive form of money? In short, he who has the gold makes the rules. The two main benefits of controlling the money supply are the ability to inflate the money supply, or a shadow tax,
and the Cantillon effect. The Cantillon effect
describes the uneven expansion of the money supply. When the central bank prints new money, those closest to the money, which in this case is banks and big corporations, profit from new, cheap money. By the time the rest of the population receives the new money, price inflation has already begun.
The Cantillon effect
results in a wealth redistribution from the poor to the rich. I care not what puppet is placed upon the throne of England to rule the empire in which the sun never sets. The man who controls Britain's money supply controls the British Empire, and I control the British money supply. The government goes to great lengths to protect their monopoly. Like e-gold in the 1990s, any competing cryptocurrency can thrive in times of peace. However, when sufficiently agitated, those in power will lash out to protect their interests. History is littered with examples. Between 2006 to 2008, the US government expanded the definition of the money transmitter license under the Patriot Act to target e-gold. In its peak, e-gold was processing over $2 billion worth of purchases per year. Unfortunately, the US government took advantage of the centralized nature of e-gold, busted down the door, and shut it down. The moral of the story is, governments do not like competition. In fact, Congressman Sherman from California recently called for a complete ban of Bitcoin. Sherman is surprisingly enlightened. He understands Bitcoin's true mission, creating a new global base money that cannot be weaponized by the global superpower du jour. Time for a new strategy. Be unstoppable. In 1984, famous Austrian economist Friedrich Hayek unknowingly laid the foundation of Bitcoin's evolutionary strategy. Be unstoppable. I don't believe we shall ever have a good money again before we take the thing out of the hands of governments. That is, we can't take it violently out of the hands of governments. All we can do is by some sly roundabout way, introduce something that they can't stop. With chilling foresight, Hayek predicted Bitcoin some 25 years prior. Satoshi obviously read Hayek, and he understood the great filter of cryptocurrencies. In 2009, Satoshi Nakamoto released an implementation of Hayek's unstoppable money. From day one, Bitcoin was engineered to survive the Great Filter. A lot of people automatically dismiss e-currency as a lost cause because of all the companies that failed since the 1990s. I hope it's obvious that it was only the centrally controlled nature of those systems that doomed them. I think this is the first time we're trying a decentralized, non-trust-based system. In order for the full potential of Bitcoin to be realized, it needs to be so resilient that even nation-state level actors cannot successfully kill Bitcoin. This meant preventing any party from having full control over the system. Parallels with fungi, the most resilient species on our planet. Over 1.3 billion years of evolution, fungi have perfected the art of staying alive. Unlike plants, fungi do not rely on sunlight. Instead, they find slash create their own food. Fungi do not have a centralized point of failure, making them resilient to attacks. Since complex life evolved on our planet, we've experienced 5 great extinction events, where 75 to 96% of all life on Earth perished. During each cataclysmic event, fungi inherited the Earth due to their antifragile nature. In an effort to survive the Great Filter, Bitcoin mimics effective evolutionary strategies observed in the fungi kingdom. Can Bitcoin survive the Great Filter? How could you kill Bitcoin? Turn off the internet? Make it illegal to use? Tax it to hell? Any cryptocurrency that cannot feasibly survive a nation-state level attack is pointless, simply delaying their inevitable demise. Satoshi designed the Bitcoin superorganism to survive the Great Filter and to resist corruption. This lofty goal kickstarted an evolutionary path separating Bitcoin from all other cryptocurrencies and blockchain projects. Does this mean Bitcoin is guaranteed to survive the Great Filter? Not necessarily. It's impossible to know until the day it suffers a coordinated attack by a state-level actor. However, Bitcoin is the only existing cryptocurrency that stands a chance. Let's explore some positive trends in Bitcoin's survivability toolbox. Bitcoin is unregulatable. No one person or entity is in charge. Code is free speech. Each country has their own competing jurisdiction. Game theory protects Bitcoin from a global coordinated attack. Nation-states compete with each other, so it's unlikely to see top nations cooperate. If the United States bans Bitcoin, China has incentive to adopt. And nations not benefiting from the current US dollar regime have an incentive to adopt Bitcoin as well. Bitcoin's proof of work protects the ledger with an energy shield. By anchoring Bitcoin to real economic value, or energy, the only way to change the ledger is to redo all the work, aka spend the same amount of money in the form of electricity. Bitcoin inspires a religious fervor from its supporters. Ideologically motivated hardliners act as an immune system. Surviving the scaling wars demonstrates this. Bitcoiners provide cover fire until Bitcoin gets through the door. Bitcoin can route around ISP censorship. Bitcoin has a growing network of alternatives to the mainstream internet, including mesh networks, ham radios, and even satellites. Maybe even routing transactions through a mycelial network, which is theoretically possible. Bitcoin is an idea. And ideas are eternal. Bitcoin spreads like a mind virus. Even if somehow the current form was killed, the idea will live on forever. And lastly, nation states underestimate Bitcoin. This buys time for Bitcoin to get stronger and harder to kill. So far, we haven't seen any serious state-level attack on Bitcoin. However, if Bitcoin continues to absorb value, there is an incentive to attack it. In the future, we'll call this period in Bitcoin's life the Great Peace. Alternative game theory, Honey Badger lives here. Bitcoin only needs to convince a few superpowers that the reward of adopting it outweighs the risk of attacking it. This game theory is similar to having a sign in the front of your house that says security system installed or big angry dog lives here. Doesn't matter if you actually have a dog or a security system, the threat alone acts like a deterrent to would-be attackers. Bitcoin has a sign in the front yard that says beware of Honey Badger. This sign reminds nation states that they cannot easily kill Bitcoin. If nation-states attempt to destroy their monetary competition, they'll highlight the very need for Bitcoin in the first place. And yet, the longer they wait, the stronger Bitcoin becomes. The blockchain industry is a red herring. First, it's important to understand that blockchainers, stablecoiners, security tokenizers, and corporate chainers do not compete with Bitcoin. They are attempting to satisfy a separate niche. By and large, the blockchain industry is a red herring, leading businesses and governments to false conclusions. Does that mean we should shun the blockchainers? No, they simply mistake blockchain hype, or the mushroom, for Bitcoin, or the mycelial network. I explained that in part 2 of the series. But we should first attempt to educate them, as most people were not born Bitcoiners. That being said, deliberate scammers deserve to be flamed. So this is how the blockchain industry helps Bitcoin. Blockchainers tie up government resources, train future developers, confuse incumbent businesses, and lull banksters to sleep. Zuckerberg will soon put a crypto wallet in everyone's pocket. Instead of competing with Bitcoin, Zuckbucks may actually attempt to compete with the United States dollar. Either way, it gets people comfortable with non-state money in their phone, similar to WeChat and Alipay. The first widespread censorship of Zuckbucks will nicely demonstrate the need for Bitcoin in the first place. Blockchainers and scammers claim Bitcoin is old and can't scale. It's Beanie Babies and MySpace. They paint Bitcoin as a friendly but limited-use fungus that brought us the blockchain. While the blockchain zeitgeist chases their tail, Bitcoin is quietly growing underground, fusing with the roots of the legacy finance system, building resilience, recruiting volunteers, infecting curious minds like a mushroom, and preparing for the great filter. If we're lucky, blockchainers will distract global superpowers just long enough for Bitcoin to become too big to fail. Hey guys, Drew again. This is part 3 of the series, so subscribe if you want to see part 4 when it comes out. And check out part 1 and 2 here. Thanks everyone.